Now, you've got the new book out. Now, give it the biggest plug. Go for it, mate. We want to sell lots and lots of copies of this. Outsiders love you, love the fight that you are fighting. So tell us about the book and talk us through what we can expect to find in there when we rush out and buy it.
Well, it goes to all the supposed major threats to the Great Barrier Reef, one after another, and in every case, with one exception, demonstrates how the reef is not threatened by agriculture and various other things. It looks at how the science has essentially been corrupted by the scientific institutions and why the institutions have ultimately become untrustworthy and unreliable. But it also looks at the history of the science itself, which really for the reef didn't start until the early 1980s, late 1970s, in earnest. So a lot of the big crashes in the reef, you know, how we get these major loss of corals and then rejuvenation, a lot of this really wasn't known until just in the last few decades. And finally, we look at how we need to reform the scientific institutions so we can get this environmental science reliable again.
Lauren?
Peter, we actually went out and saw the Great Barrier Reef together. It was gorgeous when you took me out in 2018. Can you explain to people why they are trying to deceive people about what's going on with the reef? What's the end goal there?
Well, I think they're not deliberately trying to deceive, in the sense that I think a lot of marine biologists are very, very emotional about the reef. And because sometimes, you know, vast amounts of coral will die, you know, you can have an area the size of Belgium will die overnight with a cyclone. They get very emotionally attached to the reef, and when they see it die, they lose their scientific objectivity. That is one of the main problems. So you've got unobjective scientists who also don't have the proper quality assurance systems acting within the science institutions, and you end up with this unreliable science.
Peter, Mark Latham here. Just away from the reef for a moment, how are you going with your legal fight against suppression of your academic freedom? You're a great fighter there. Academic freedom should be the foundation stone of any university. How's your fight going, and what can people do to support you?
Well, it's going not too badly. The High Court have set a hearing date sometime in February to decide whether they're going to hear our challenge. So we lost in the federal court, but we won in the lower court. So we think we've got a good chance of getting to the High Court. The federal government has instituted, with One Nation's help, actually, the new academic freedom provisions with inside the Higher Education Act. So, in fact, in terms of academic freedom, I think things are going ahead slowly, but we're getting there.
Are you happy with those new provisions? I had a look at them and they look reasonably strong, but, you know, they come out of all the distress that your case has caused. Are you happy with those amendments that have gone through the Parliament?
Yeah, I mean, I think that more is needed, but they're certainly a very good foundation, and I thank all the politicians, including Pauline Hanson and Minister Tehan, for doing that. We need more, though, in the sense that it's one thing to have a law, but it's only if the universities know that that law is going to be prosecuted and there's going to be big fines if you break it, that they're actually going to comply with it. You know, you can have speeding regulations, but if you know you're never going to be caught, everybody will speed. At the moment, the universities are so confident that they can crush any academic who speaks out of line. Unless there's a $10 million fine when they get it wrong, they will just keep on going ahead with what they've already keep on doing.
They're critically important. At least we know Senator Hanson and Minister Tehan are fair dinkum about this. And as you say, the implementation will be all important. Rowan?
Yeah, absolutely. Peter, it amused me, but it won't have amused you or surprised you even, that there was a report out of West Australia's Rowley Shoals the other day where they said they were astonished. The coral bleaching, it had all regrown, it had all come back. What on earth happened there?
Well, this happens about every year. We have this surprise. The scientists are surprised about how well the reef has recovered. But it always does it. In fact, in my book, my first picture is a picture of the Bikini Atoll, the nuclear atomic blast, which is on a coral reef. And they exploded an atom bomb 1,000 times bigger than the Hiroshima bomb. And, of course, the corals just recovered and the biologists were surprised, which is fair enough to be surprised. But we shouldn't keep on being surprised when the coral crashes and then recovers. It's like a bushfire and it then recovers. And it's always done it and it always will do it. But unfortunately, unless we bring our scientists under control, we're always going to be having these doom stories from the scientists, and then they'd be surprised about 2 years later.
Well, I always feel sorry for the Crown of Thorns. They were the villains when I was growing up, and they've been completely eclipsed and forgotten about now. And they were doing, you know, there you go, it's now climate change, of course, as is everything. Peter Ridd, where can people get the book?
They can get it at Connacourt Publishing. Just Google Connacourt Peter Ridd and you should better find it somehow.
Fantastic. Looking forward to it. Thanks, Peter. Take care.
Thanks very much.